A new crazy detailed fossil find has nailed down the origins of the arthropods and their early evolution. The exquisite preservation of the remains of a tiny larva from early Cambrian deposits of China is revealing a lot that we didn't yet know about this pivotal moment in evolution. Named Youti, Yuanshi, it gives a rare glimpse into the internal anatomy of the earliest true arthropods, representing an important stepping stone towards this successful group of animals. Now we finally have a clear idea of what the earliest ancestors of arthropods were like on the inside. So what fascinating details does UT show, and how does this enhance our understanding of the evolution of arthropods? Let's find out, shall we? For a very long time now, onychophorans, or velvet worms, have been linked to the arthropods as the sole survivors of an archaic ancestral lineage. These have always appeared like the perfect invertebrate ancestors of arthropods. Soft-bodied, yet segmented, and bearing repetitive lobe-like legs. But exactly how the transition occurred between these and the arthropods, and how they might be related to other invertebrate phyla, had been shrouded in the mists of time. The segmented worms called annelids, comprising earthworms, ragworms, and leeches, were once thought to be the next closest relatives. This changed over the last several decades or so with a chain of discoveries. Creatures apparently closely similar to onychophorans had been known from the early Cambrian for over a century, thanks to the Canadian deposits of the Burgess Shale that showcases many wondrous stem group animals. Amongst those was Aishiaia, that is one of the earliest known forms of a group of lobed feet worms that have become known as Lobopodia. This established the Onychophora as having ancient roots and apparently not having departed all too far from the basic Lobopodian body plan. And even tardigrades are now believed to have derived from this same ancient stock. This makes sense because tardigrades basically look like a miniaturized and highly simplified Lobopodian. Then, during the 90s, molecular phylogeny finally established that all invertebrate animals with a layered cuticle that's shed regularly belong together with this as their unifying feature. They are aptly named Ecdysozoa after their molting process known as ecdysis. It also became clear that, ancestrally at least, Ecdysozoans possess variations on a ring of spikes around the mouth called an oral cone. Within this very diverse grouping, Lobopodians and arthropods tied together in a grouping that has been dubbed the Panarthropoda. Fully formed arthropods with complete exoskeletons, including all modern forms and their descendants, are known as the Euarthropoda, or in other words, the true arthropods. Increasing fossil discoveries from the early Cambrian have uncovered a huge diversification of several early Lobopodian lineages. It showed an enormous variation in the size and specialization of their many lobed appendages, and even the rise of swimming forms like, for instance, Kerygmachela, shown here. Also, further analysis revealed that strange, seemingly disparate fossil creatures like Hallucigenia, Opabinia, and Anomalocaris all cluster around or even inside the stem of Panarthropoda. So how does UT fit into this? Though only about 4 mm in length and still being in a larval stage, it's got almost all of its major internal structures preserved as imprints in the sedimentary rocks. UT is straddling this transition from stem Lobopodian lineages to the true arthropods by combining traits from both. Before this find, we had to guess a lot about the internal anatomy of early arthropods and Lobopodians, but UT is now nimbly connecting a lot of pieces of the puzzle. So how does it complete the picture? Before UT, scientists were always a bit uncertain on how to interpret the internal structures found in several other well-preserved Panarthropod fossils. But in this fossil, we can clearly see two key anatomical features that confirm and add to many earlier hypotheses. To begin with, there are serially repeated structures along the gut that can confidently be interpreted as digestive glands, shown in mustard green in the reconstruction here. These digestive glands indicate carnivory and are known only from Euarthropods. In addition to that, there is a secondary system of sinuses and cavities all throughout the body. This corresponds to a circulatory system called the lacunar system that is still seen in modern-day onychophorans, but also in highly derived arthropods like crustaceans. In onychophorans, the primary system of fluid-filled cavities called the perivascular system forms the hydrostatic skeleton and extends deep into the lobopods, as it clearly does in Youti as well. So this illustrates how this transition happened and what the intermediate stage was like. But wait, there's more! In Euarthropods, the nervous system runs down the body on the belly side, with each segment usually having a node of neurons called a ganglion associated with a pair of legs. In the head area, there's a large accumulation of neuronal nodes forming the arthropod brain. The interesting thing is that the arthropod brain itself is segmented into three main parts: a protocerebrum, a deutocerebrum, and a tritocerebrum. These divisions are generally believed to derive from ancestral body segments fusing into the head, with each contributing a ganglion and an associated pair of appendages. However, there is a long-running dispute on exactly how and precisely what segments morphed into the full head of different arthropod lineages. This is called the arthropod head problem and deserves its own dedicated video. The researchers who studied UT established that one part of the protocerebrum, here referred to as the prosocerebrum, is associated with the ring of nerves around the mouth. The other part of the protocerebrum, the so-called archicerebrum, is associated with the sensory apparatus, especially the eyes, and is formed as an additional outgrowth. So there's now a clear picture of the evolutionary stages leading up to a true arthropod that are as follows. The primitive state of the Ecdysozoan ancestors of Panarthropods is a soft-bodied, unsegmented worm with a hydrostatic skeleton and a circle of spikes around the mouth. This is very much like a modern-day priapulid worm. The nervous system is made of a ring of nerves around the throat called the circumoral ring, with longitudinal nerve strands running down the length of the body. In the next stage, the earliest Panarthropods, the body is divided into segments, each sporting a pair of limbs and the associated ganglia to control these. The circumoral nerve ring is expanded to form the protocerebrum to deal with the appendages on each side of the mouth, plus the archicerebrum in extension to that, near a pair of eyes. This stage is still represented today by the onychophorans and tardigrades, who also sport a pair of appendages or structures all the way in the front called the frontal filaments, and like UT does as well. The final stage is represented by swimming lobopodians like Kerygmachela that have an outgrowth of the head called the anterior lobe, which holds the expanded archicerebrum. This trait is carried forward into the earliest true arthropods, whose body and leg segments finally are completely hardened on the outside and therefore no longer need the internal hydroskeleton made up of fluid-filled cavities. Beginnings of this process called arthrodization can be seen in radiodonts like Anomalocaris. Being nectic carnivores like the swimming lobopodians, they've encased their archicerebral brain with hardened head sclera as well as their raptorial head appendages. The head appendages have become fully arthrodized in these protoarthropods, while the rest of the body retained a softer cuticle. The arthrodization of the entire body is then seen in stem arthropods like Megachira and Fushan huida. Here we also see further civilization by drawing in additional appendages into the head, incorporating their ganglia into an ever-growing brain region. So there you have it. Another piece of the puzzle added to this evolutionary mystery that is becoming ever more resolved. If you want to learn more about how evolution arrived at the arthropod body plan and what this could mean for alien biospheres, check out this video on my channel dedicated to the arthropod recipe. So what do you think? Could the adult form of Youti have been very similar to the famous swimming predator Anomalocaris? Could the early evolution of Panarthropods have gone in a different direction and maybe have developed internal skeletons and outcompeted the vertebrate fish, maybe? Let us know in the comments. If you liked this video, please give it a thumbs up and maybe even a sub if you haven't already. Thanks for sticking around, and till next time, stay sharp and stay evolved!